Last week, we started a series on closed doors. I meant to count how many doors we have in this church this week, and I forgot about it until just a minute ago when I was sitting there, and I was trying to do it in my head. Didn't work. Some days it works, and some days it just doesn't work, folks. Y'all understand? Amen. Physically, we understand the principle of a door. An open door means come in. A locked door means stay out. But biblically, a closed door represents you being alone with the Lord, for whatever reason that may be. So I'm doing a series on the shut doors. The text I used to introduce that is Matthew 6:6, but thou when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, shut the door. Pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Now, that doesn't mean literally go to your closet and shut yourself in. You could. And when I was a kid, closets were enough to hang some clothes in. Today, closets are rooms. And so, it could mean that. The principle is, of a shut door in the Bible, is get along with God. Sometimes God does that for you. And sometimes God wants you to do that. And so, the shut door speaks of a place of comfort, a place of solitude, a place of instruction, a place of renewal, a place of blessing. We used to sing a song, I haven't heard it in years, Take Time to Be Holy. And the principle of that song is take time to be alone with God. That principle is played out in symbolism a lot in the book of the Song of Solomon, where the bride, talking about the groom, says in Solomon 2:14, let me see thy countenance, let me hear thy voice, for sweet is thy voice, and thy countenance is comely. And the way God wants to operate with you is he wants you alone sometimes so he can deal with you and we can pour our hearts out to him. So that's the principle of the shut door. I used two illustrations last week to get us started. One was in Ezekiel chapter number 3, where God said to Ezekiel, go shut thyself within thine house. And Ezekiel, of course, was a major prophet preaching to the nation, and they just weren't interested. They'd stopped listening. And finally, God said, no sense in talking to them anymore. Just go home. Quit talking. That was the principle of go shut thyself within the house. And there, God dealt with him privately about what was going on in the nation. And after a while, he was allowed to preach again, though it did not do any good. But God got to a point with his own people where he said, they're just not going to listen. Just quit preaching and go home. I hope we don't ever get to that point in America. We're moving in that direction pretty quickly, but I hope we never get there. So we talked about that, and I brought out that under those circumstances. How many times the Lord in his own personal life on earth either went out in the garden, spent the night, or he went to a mountaintop and he was alone with God? We know that the Apostle Paul, after he was saved, which completely turned his theology upside down, and he went back to his hometown for, we think, about 3 years, and then came forth and began his ministry. The shut door for Moses was 40 long years on the backside of the desert, and God got him ready to be the leader. The apostles understood well the principle of the closed door. We will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And then we talked about something else last week. The Shador is the place of safety. And we went to Lot, the story of Lot. Every spiritual decision in Lot's life was wrong. He was raised by his uncle, a godly man, Abraham. And finally, after enough wrong turns in his life, he ended up in the wicked cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, even rose to being a councilman, because that's what it meant in the Old Testament to be sitting at the gate. That meant he was a councilman. He was a leader. And finally, because of the wickedness of Sodom and Gomorrah, God said, I'm going to destroy it. He said that to Abraham. And Abraham said back to God, now wait a minute, Lot's in there. And are you really going to destroy the righteous with the wicked? Now, when we go to the book of 2 Peter, we find out Lot, even though he lived a totally bad life, he really was a Christian. And so Abraham pleaded with God, and so finally, after that lengthy prayer meeting, God, because there weren't enough saved people there, got down to 10. And there weren't 10 saved people there. Lot didn't even win his own family. And so finally God said, I'm going to destroy it, but I'm going to send a couple of angels down there to get Lot out. And so the angels went to Lot's house. Lot brought him in, treated him royally. And the men of the city, who were such sexual perverts, came to the door to Lot and said, Lot, we want those two men out here so we can abuse them. And that meant sexual perversion. And Lot said, you can't do that. These are my guests. Now, we don't know if Lot knew those were angels or not. Probably not. And Lot stepped outside the door and argued with him, and he wouldn't get anywhere. And the men were fixing to just storm in. And so the angels grabbed Lot, pulled him back in the house, and shut the door. And then struck those men out there with blindness. And you know the rest of the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. So we looked at the fact that the shut door in the Bible can be a place of safety. And that's something that God does for us sometimes. Sometimes we get our lives in a situation to where we are in danger. And sometimes other people get our lives in a situation where we're in danger. And God miraculously shuts the door on the evil that would consume us and protects us. And by the way, that's what the 91st Psalm is all about. It talks about being in the place under the shadow of the Almighty, and that's the closed door of God protecting us. So this morning, I want us to look at another shut door in the Bible. And I call this the shut door is the place of searching. Now, if you want to turn back in the Old Testament to Leviticus, it's Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. So that'll kind of give you some direction. But back in the book of Leviticus, what's Leviticus all about? Leviticus is named for the tribe of Levi, which was the priestly tribe. And it is the book of instruction to the priests how to minister. And one of the things the priests had to do is to determine if someone in the camp had leprosy. And so Leviticus chapter number 13 and 14 deals with instruction to the priests of how to deal with leprosy. Now let me say this about leprosy. It's a blood disease that comes out and literally consumes the body, and it's a horrible, horrible, ugly disease. They have a few things that kind of can deal with it now, but back in those days they had nothing. And it's so contagious that once they found out someone had leprosy, they were shut out of the city. Could not come into contact with anybody. It was a terrible, isolated life, and it was a terrible death. Leprosy, so bad, in the Bible, it stands for sin. Leprosy is always a synonym for sin. So how to deal with a leper? Well, the entire 13th and 14th chapter deals with that subject, but I want to only go to chapter 13 and read the first six verses, and that'll make my point. So in Leviticus 13:1, "And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron, saying, When a man shall have in the skin of his flesh arising a scab or bright spot, and it be in the skin of his flesh like the plague of leprosy, then he shall be brought unto Aaron the priest, or unto one of his sons the priests. And the priest shall look on the plague in the skin of his flesh, when the hair in the plague is turned white, and the plague in the sight be deeper than the skin of his flesh, it is a plague of leprosy. And the priest shall look on him and pronounce him unclean. If the bright spot be white in the skin of his flesh, and in the sight be not deeper than the skin, and the hair thereof be not turned white, then the priest shall shut up him that hath the plague 7 days." There was a question whether it was the real thing or not. The person suspected of having leprosy was shut up, kept in a closed room for 7 days. Verse 5, "And the priest shall look on him the seventh day, and behold, if the plague in his side be at a stay, and the plague spread not in the skin, then the priest shall shut him up 7 more days, twice 7 days each. And the priest shall look on him again the seventh day, and behold, if the plague be somewhat dark, and the plague spread not in the skin, the priest shall pronounce him clean. It is but a scab. And he shall wash his clothes and be clean, and then was allowed to go back into society." So here we have another case in the Bible where there is an occasion for someone to be behind closed door. Now, I know that it's probably impossible for us to do, but I want you to think. Here's a man, we're talking about a man in this particular situation, those men, women, children, everybody got it. And by the way, there's still places in third world countries in the world today where leprosy is still alive and well. And so here's a man that catches something and he's brought to the priest, and the priest looks at it and said, might be leprosy, and the man has to be shut up for 7 days. And then it's looked at again. And if it's still not certain which way to go, he is shut up for 7 more days. So you've got a man, a person, that potentially has something that's going to cause him to have a horrible, horrible death. And he is isolated all alone for 14 days. Can you imagine what a time of personal searching and wondering and questioning and fearing and testing? Can you imagine the fear of heart of the individual suspected of having leprosy and its possible consequences? Now, the application is quite simple. Not leprosy, but such times of searching and testings do come into our lives as Christians. Sooner or later, if you're a real child of God, sooner or later, something may come along that will force you to be alone, to be bedridden. If I may use our Miss Esther for an illustration, last year she went through a lengthy time due to a very serious illness where she was alone. Sometimes God gets us alone, but never for a bad reason. The circumstances may be negative, but God always has a definitely good reason. Isaiah 41:30-31 says, "They that wait upon the Lord." That's the principle of the shut door. "They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Sometimes, times of searching God brings into our lives. Jacob had such an experience. I mentioned this in the Sun School Hour. Jacob had such an experience where he was to go meet his brother that he hadn't seen in 20 years. And the last time he saw his brother said, "Next time I see you, I'm going to kill you." And then the shepherds that had gone ahead when it was time for the meeting said, "Your brother's coming with 400 men. "Well, you don't need 400 men to say, "Hi, brother, glad you're back." Scared him to death. And he rearranged his life. He put his family, his stock, his wife, kids, everything. He placed them on the north side of the river. And he went back and spent the night alone with God. And what a night of heart searching and confession that must have been. But that incident turned Jacob into Israel, a prince with God. Isaiah in chapter number 6, if you read the book of Isaiah, there came a time in Isaiah's life, about 3 years into his ministry, things were not going well. The people weren't listening. They were slandering him. As a prophet, it was not going well, like it did with most of the Old Testament prophets. It never went well. Finally, he got alone with God, and you have the incident in Isaiah chapter 6 where he sees a vision of the glorified Lord. And God assured him and recommissioned him. And then he went back to ministry, and he ended up being the longest serving prophet of all the prophets in the Bible, well over 60 years of ministry. But there came that crisis when he had to be alone with God. Now what about the Apostle Paul? Bible doesn't really say what his physical ailments were, but he was not a well man. And finally he got to a place where whatever it was, a lot of people think it was his eyes because of some things that are said about that in the Bible, but we don't really know what his problem was. But finally his sickness got so bad, it was a major problem for him in ministry. And so he got along with God. And he prayed repeatedly for God to take it away. And finally God said, "Look, I'm not going to take that away. You're going to live with that. But I'll give you grace." Yeah. And from that point on, Paul was able to go back to ministry, live with the problem, and God gave him grace. Look, I don't care what you hear on television. Let me tell you something. God's not always going to solve your problems. He may want you to live with your problems, but he'll give you grace. He'll either take it away or give you grace. God may want you to live with your problem, because the truth of the matter is, that's when we stay humble. That's when we empty of ourselves. That's when we rely on God, and that's when God can use us. Because God said to Paul, he said, "You know, when you're weak, that's when you're strong." So Paul said, "Okay, I'll just be weak if you'll help me." God said, "I will help you." That was his closed door. What about Peter? Went to Joppa, was at Simon's house. He's up on the roof, alone, praying and waiting on God. God was fixing to send him to Gentiles. Well, boy, that's the last thing a good Jew wanted to do. Remember those of you that come on Wednesday night? We just went through that with Jonah. And so God knew that if he sent Peter to the Gentiles, like Peter was in his mind against Gentiles, that just wasn't going to work. So he got him alone on the rooftop for a season of prayer. That rooftop was the closed door for Peter. And God gave him a vision. And God taught him, "I'm going to save some Gentiles. And you're going to go do it." That was the closed door. In John chapter 15, Lord talks about pruning us. Pruning us. You know when you prune someone, when you prune a tree, now I'm not a horticulturist, but I did listen to Mr. Cunningham this morning on Channel 5. He was talking about this is the time while the trees are digging, planting and pruning them. That's what God does to us. He sometimes takes us out of circulation. He sometimes puts us quiet. He sometimes symbolically puts us behind a closed door so he can prune us. And we know that that is good for a tree and for the vineyard when spring comes. And folks, that's usually preparation in our lives for future effective service. Times of searching and testing are good for us. It's time of confession of sins. It's time of seeking the Lord. It's time of revival. And it's time of renewal. And we are always better after times of quiet, searching, and testing. Turn back, if you will, to the book of Ecclesiastes. It's after the book of Proverbs. Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes. Time of testing. What will it do for us? Well, Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse number 1. A good name is better than precious ointment. And the day of death, the day of one's birth. Now, we don't think like that at all, do we? But that's what God says. Now, look at verse number 2. It is better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting. For that is the end of all men, and the living will lay it to heart. Any preacher will tell you, you preach to more lost people at a funeral than you will within the walls of a church in a year or two or longer. Because when they stare at that casket, they know that one of these days they're going to be in one and you've got their attention. Then look at verse 3, sorrow is better than laughter. For by the sadness of the countenance, the heart is made better. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of the fools is in the house of mirth. Everybody wants to go to a party. We're a society now that's all we live for is the weekend. Where can we go? Where's a concert? Where's a party? Where's the wine flowing? Where's the gambling? That doesn't help people. That destroys people. Being here helps people. Amen? Verse 5. It's better to hear the rebuke of the wise than for man to hear the song of fools. By the way, is that a message that our society needs to hear or what? We're always better after times of quiet and searching and testing. The Shador is the place of heart searching. About 100 years ago, there lived a man by the name of George Mueller. George Mueller was not a preacher in the sense that we call preachers today, but he was a great Christian. And George Mueller was the original track maker, producer, and distributor in the modern Western world. George Mueller printed millions of tracks and they went all over the world. George Mueller lived in Bristol, England. In his life, he raised over 10,000 orphans. He built orphanages in several places in England and he and his staff raised over 10,000 orphans in those years. And what's significant about George Mueller is he never asked one person ever for one thing done. He was a a man of God, he's a man of prayer, and every need for the printing ministry, every need to raise and feed those orphans, he got alone with God and stayed there. He spent an enormous amount of his life behind what you and I would call closed doors with the Lord. Late in life, of course, and by the way, at great price, personal price, which we don't have time to get into that. Someone asked him late in life, how did you do that? And his standard answer was only four words, live alone with God. You see, your public life and the success of your public life is determined by your private life with God, if you're a Christian. And when you win with God, then you win with people. And if God's got something he wants you to do, very likely, like the leper, God, through some circumstance, will get you alone and get you ready. The shut door is the place of searching. I've time to look at one more shut door. And I want to call this the shut door is the place of supply. 2 Kings chapter number 4. And this is a very interesting story about Christians being in debt. I hope you pay close attention to this story. But in 2 Kings chapter number 4, I'm going to read the first 7 verses. It's an interesting story. Now there cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets, a preacher, unto Elisha the prophet, saying, thy servant, my husband, is dead. Thou knowest that thy servant did fear the Lord, and the creditor is come to take unto him my 2 sons to be bondmen. In the old days, if you made a debt and you couldn't pay it, you went to a debtor's prison and you worked your debt off. So the creditors, he died, he had some debts, couldn't pay him. So the creditor that he owed money to was coming to get the sons to work off the father's debt. And Elisha said unto her, what shall I do for thee? Tell me, what hast thou in thy house? And she said, thine handmaid hath anything in the house but a pot of oil. Then he said, go borrow thee vessels abroad of all thy neighbors, even empty vessels, borrow not a few. In other words, borrow all the empty, get all the empty vessels that you can find. And when that come in, thou shalt shut thy door upon thee and upon thy sons. We'll come back to that. And you'll pour out into all those vessels, and thou shalt set aside that which is full. So she went from him and shut the door upon her and upon her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured out. And it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said unto her son, bring me more vessels. And he said unto her, they said unto her, there are no more vessels, and the oil stayed. It's amazing. The supply didn't stop till the need was met. Then she came and told the man of God, and he said, go sell the oil and pay thy debt. Live thou and thy children off the rest. Great story. Amazing story. There's so many wonderful lessons there. You got a need? Go to God. Don't go to the bank. Go to God. If you're a Christian, go to God. That's what he wants you to do. She met her liability without, by the supply she got within. Did God not say, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory? The main principle of the Christian life, the measure of our giving out, is subject to the quantity we take in. Now, if you're empty, you can't do a whole lot of good for anybody else, let alone yourself. By the way, oil is the symbol of the Holy Spirit. John 14:16, I will pray the Father, and he shall send you another comforter that he may abide with you forever. Galatians 5:22, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Romans 8:14, but as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Acts 1:8, but ye shall see power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me. Here's the principle of the shut door being the place of supply. We see the need of going to God first. And then we're able to let our light shine without. If you're trying to serve the Lord and you're not first full of the Holy Spirit and full of the Word and full of the blessing of the Lord, and if your cup is not full and if your light's not burning, it's hard to be a blessing to anybody else. So this story of this lady and her children and how the prophet got her behind closed doors and figured it out and how to meet the need. There's a physical application and there's a spiritual application. The physical application is simply this, Philippians 4:19, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory. Go to God. And then there's a spiritual application. Matthew 5:16. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. You know, I just from dealing with people my whole life and seeing how the whole Christianity thing is going in our beloved country today, I can tell you without any reservation, we need to learn to lean on the world a whole lot less and lean on the Lord a whole lot more. Amen?
Amen.
That's what the principle of the shut door in the Bible is all about. I just pray that the Lord will add his blessing to this series and that we'll grow in grace and trust the world less and trust the Lord more and not make rash decisions or even long thought decisions without seeking the mind, get alone and seek the mind of God first. Amen. Would you stand, please? With every head bowed, my clothes. Maybe someone's here, you've never received the Lord. That has to be first. Nothing I have said really applies to you if you're not a believer, if you're not a Christian, if the Holy Spirit is not living inside of you, have not to the Lord confessed your sins and yielded your life to the Lord. And that has to be first. And then, of course, public profession, baptism. Then you begin the Christian life. But I have mostly done my very best in this series. I'm really speaking to Christians to encourage us. We are such a driven society, and that spirit has got into our churches. And we are so success oriented, and we're so we got to do, we got to go, we got to do, we got to go. No, and there is a time for that, but not first. First, there is the principle. getting alone with God, being full of what He has for us, and then going. And I just pray, I really mean it, that this message has spoken to your heart, and the Lord will do a work of grace. And so I'm going to pray, and then we're going to sing. And if you need to come and receive Christ, if I can pray with you, if you need to come and join the church, whatever the need of your life is, whatever the Lord is dealing with you about, this would be your time to respond. So let me pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. It does teach us. And Lord, if we're not careful, we get so bombarded with whatever everybody's got to say that we need to do that. We sometimes forget, as Christians, we need to first find out from you and then do. Help us, Lord, to have receptive spirits to your word and then to act on the word of God, not on the temperament of man. May this message be a blessing in the hearts and minds and lives of the people who are here. Now have your will and way in every heart and mind and life, I pray, in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Amen. What number?
Right.